You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, I'm Professor Thomas Norman, and this is Management 310, Management Theory. This is the first part of Module 2. Today we're going to do a brief review of Chapter 1. We're going to discuss the McDonald's assignment that's a key part of this course, and then we'll begin working with the material in Chapter 2, external and internal environments. Okay, our learning objectives for this session are the first four: how environmental factors influence organizations, and how, in turn, an organization can influence its environment. We're going to look at the macro environment, meaning the big picture. When you hear somebody say 10,000-foot level, looking at above, what does an organization look like relative to the competitive environment? So not the ins and outs of what's going on inside the company, but how the company compares to others. Why managers and organizations should attend to economic and social phenomenon. One of the reasons I encourage you to be reading the newspaper, reading journals, watching news programs during this course, so you can connect some of these things. All right, so a review from our last episode, Chapter 1. There we discussed management perspectives over time, and we maybe noticed a trend that the initial scientific theory, the Taylor's theory, got replaced by more humanistic theories, more people-focused. And I shouldn't say replace, but more attention was paid to the person, and then the next trend or wave might be focused on the process, the science, the numbers. So we've talked about that, and that everything that we're discussing will change over time. Remember, management theory, as we're studying it, we really look back to the 19th century and then the last century. This is an era of great change where we were moving from the farm to the factory system to the Industrial Revolution. This revolution is going on today in much of the emerging world. The China success story is very much moving from a country that struggled to feed its people to a country that is now the world's manufacturing center. Whereas the U.S. economy is going through the shift from the manufacturing era to the knowledge economy. The type of economy, type of structure, affects the training, affects the employees or the types of workers that a society needs to prepare to be successful in this economy. Okay, and we then talked about these three subfields, which will come in very important as you visit your McDonald's and as you visit another franchise restaurant to analyze what's going on. Can you still see evidence of Taylor's scientific management? Can you see evidence of Max Weber's notion of a bureaucracy, bureaucracy meaning a good thing, things being ordered and fair and logical? And can you see any of Henri Fayol's administrative principles when you visit the McDonald's? And to remind those of you working on your essay about what you've seen and if McDonald's is a mechanistic company, here's the grading rubric. How well have you described those characteristics? That'll be 20%. Have you mentioned those three thinkers? And have you related something you saw at McDonald's to their ideas? That's a quarter of the grade. Have you presented a clear case for why McDonald's has been successful? 10%. And then are you able to compare and contrast with the organization of your choice? Could be your own restaurant. I teach this course in Africa, so it could be a local version of your McDonald's or your Kentucky Fried Chicken. And then 15% is demonstrating an understanding of when the mechanistic approach works versus the opposite, which we would call the organic approach. What are some of the weaknesses, especially as they relate to being innovative in our rapidly changing economy? And of course, I'd like you to write clearly, succinctly, not too short, not too long. The four functions of management we'll be repeating again and again in this course. All intro to management courses seem to have gravitated towards these four big ideas: planning, organizing, leading, and controlling. I want to focus a little bit in on the third one, leading. And when we talk about leading, we're talking about people, human beings, often called human resources in organizations. Here's how I define human resources for my students. I want you to get away from the notion that human resources simply equals employees. human resources are much broader than that. Let's take this definition apart. I'm talking to you about the talents and the energies of people, could be employees, could not be, who are available to an organization. Well, who's a person that's not employed that might be available? Could be a volunteer. Linux, one of the main operating systems, was created by a bunch of volunteers. It wasn't paid employees at IBM or my former employer Sun Microsystems that created Linux. My company promoted Unix, the base system there, but a bunch of volunteers helped to improve the Linux system. Sometimes customers find themselves as resources. I remember going to the airport and seeing a lot more employees. There would be people to help me with my bag, people to help print out my ticket. Today, computers and the passenger do a lot of the work, and we're actually happy that we don't have to wait in as many lines and deal with as many people. We can print our own boarding pass, we can print our own luggage tag, and just drop that bag off and walk right to the gate where we might see our first airline employee that's helping us to get onto the plane. So that's a source of talent. What's the next part of this definition? We're going to look at the creation and realization of an organization's mission, vision, goals, and objectives. Okay, so that's what we're trying to get done. So talents and energies relate to my vision of human resources are only good if they can do the job that needs to be done, and if they have the energy and the will and the desire to actually do that. Knowing how to do something is of no value to me as a manager if you don't want to do it. Or maybe you'll do it, but you'll do it just good enough not to get fired. Or you'll do it in such a way that actually hurts the customer experience and makes the customer not want to come back. Think of a restaurant maybe you've gone to where you've seen somebody on their phone and you're waiting to place your order and they're going to finish that conversation before you place your order. You know, I myself have walked away from such a restaurant. They might argue, hey, I'm there, I'm taking orders, but are they really doing it with their full energy? I would say not. Here's an executive who's often looked over in Silicon Valley. You've probably heard of Steve Jobs, you've probably heard of Bill Gates. Many of you probably have not heard of John Chambers. Cisco Systems is one of the most important companies in the Silicon Valley ecosystem. He just recently retired. And he shared a definition of the strategic importance of managing your people or your human resources well that I'd like you to think about as we continue with this course. So he wrote, the Industrial Revolution was about economies of scale. Economies of scale from economics means bigger is better. We're seeing this in China today. China's outcompeting most countries because it can build massive factories with the latest equipment with lower cost labor. And that gives them an overall advantage because that one factory can be divided among 10 million iPhones, right? A best-selling product, maybe manufactured by Foxconn in China for Apple. The internet revolution, he said at the time, I would paraphrase this for this course, I call it the knowledge revolution. This is about economies of skill and how you empower people, okay? And that's what I want you to think about in this course, that your job as a manager is managing people, managing money. I would argue those are pretty easy compared to people. A dollar is going to be worth a dollar if you yell at it. You crumple it up, it's still worth a dollar. You yell at an employee, that value may change. May work harder for a short period of time and start working less hard when you're not around talking about you and quitting. You know, objects don't care how they're treated. Treating them poorly, yes, they can deteriorate faster. But they don't have feelings, they don't evolve, they tend not to learn. So the Industrial Revolution is about economies of scale, bigger is better. Think of the mechanistic and our early management thinkers. And then as we go through some of the concepts, think about the second piece of this, our current era that we're in is really about economies of scale, how you manage and empower people. So now let's get right into the textbook material where we're going to describe that macro environment, the big picture with some local examples, and we're going to do a competitive environment model. The authors of the book, I want you to first understand systems theory and some of the basics of a system to place an organization in the wider context, in its external environment. So they define open system as having inputs and outputs. and the organizations affected by the environment. So if you're taking raw minerals, you're taking knowledge from Apple to create an Apple iPhone, right? You're taking those inputs. You could be doing it in California with a certain legal system, certain environmental standards. You could be doing it in Taiwan. You could be doing it in China. And the output would be the Apple iPhone 10, for example. So that's an open system. Things are moving through the system. And the external environment, what we want to consider is anything that's relevant to how that firm operates outside the boundaries of the firm, okay? What goes on, how the firm manages itself, the steps between the components and the final product, that's inside. But perhaps there's a tariff imposed on iPhone from China to the United States. That's outside the system. Perhaps there's a strike, a shipping strike that prevents some of the minerals from Africa reaching the port of China. That would be external. Okay, so maybe there's a rival inside China that's making a phone that's more popular than the Apple iPhone. That's a competitor. A customer preferences could change. Maybe Chinese customers are choosing not to buy iPhones because their leader tells them it's no longer patriotic. The government can be very involved, government taxes, just its position and attitude toward products, and the overall economy. When the economy is booming, people have more money to buy phones. When the economy is not doing so well, maybe the focus is going to be on 99-cent apps and things that you'll use on your existing phone, and maybe the software updates become more and more important. Okay, so the competitive environment is defined as all those things around the firm, the suppliers, competitors, customers, rivals, and such. The macro environment is that general environment, including the government, overall economic conditions, and any factor that would generally affect all organizations, not just manufacturers, restaurants, farmers, mines, etc. Okay, the international components, very important for your generation. Globalization's influencing everything that we do today. Globalization has pros and cons. It's not all bad, it's not all good. The opening up of borders to new markets allows American companies to sell to China, to countries they couldn't sell to before, but it also means that some of our products may face competition they didn't face before. When I was taking courses like this, back from 1988 to 1992, there were 3 billion fewer people that I had to compete with. At that time, the people in India, the people in the Soviet Union, the people in China were not very integrated in the economy, so I didn't have to worry about that competition. Fast forward to today, definitely that's a major change that affects every manager and every employee. Technology is such that the internet was just being deployed commercially when I was graduating. Email was a new thing that was really exciting. A network-connected printer was very exciting. Today, we feel at a loss when we don't have our phone next to us. We have instant information available from Google. Okay, I can remember the day when I had to go to the library to find information from a magazine. I would go to stacks to find old magazines. Today, just a few clicks or even a voice command perhaps, and I can look at an article from 1890 from the New York Times about trade relations between the United States and Great Britain. Economic trends. We have up economies, we have down economies. 2019 so far, the economy is booming. Employers are struggling to find people to do many jobs in California. When I moved here 11 years ago, that was right before the Great Recession of 2008. My students struggled to find jobs. As someone who graduated during the recession of 1992, I can empathize. It wasn't as bad as the current one, but there were not as many companies coming on campus as there were 2 years previously or 3 years afterwards. So as a leader of an organization, know that your organization needs to compete and think globally. A quick little graphic just to show you how things have changed. So on the bottom, you see the years. We can go back to 0 BC, okay, or 0 AD. And who were the largest economies as historians and economists have figured out? Well, India's got a large population today. It had a pretty large population then, relatively, as did China. Those were the two leading economies. Now, what happens during the Industrial Revolution? Take a look at the purple line. That's the United States. Remember, compared to most countries, the United States is still a toddler, or at best, maybe an adolescent. We're a pretty new country. Western Europe, okay, where many people that founded the United States came from, okay, that during this period of Industrial Revolution, if we look on the chart, the 1700s, we see a great increase in the percentage of GDP created by the Western European people. Let me just go back. If you forgot what GDP is, that's gross national product. That's a measure in dollars of how much everybody's creating. All the cheese, milk, clothes, boats, you know, today to guns, to tanks, to jet fighters, to software that are being produced. And you saw that inflection point where China and India fell as a percentage of what was being created, even though their populations didn't change as much, and Western Europe became much more productive. Why was that? Because of the application of these management strategies that we're discussing in this course. The United States followed suit very quickly, and in fact, when you look at this graph, you see surpassed Western Europe and has been kind of neck and neck. Now, what's been amazing in my lifetime as someone born in 1970 is look at the rebound of China. If we look historically, it hasn't surprised me that China has become as dominant as it is. It has had a history of innovation and of great management practices, and as it's transforming, adopting some good ideas from the West, maybe pioneering some new ideas, we're seeing it rebound. Whereas some areas like the Middle East have stayed fairly low, and India is on an increase, but a smaller increase. So that helps you think about what's happening in the globe and why I encourage you to not just read U.S. publications, but try to read publications from other countries. If you can read British, for example, you'll get a much better understanding of the world economy from The Economist or the London Times. So back to the textbook, here's Exhibit 2.1, showing you that open perspective. The external environment affects everything, affects the inputs, and then it gets the organization where that transformation process, the ideas on how to make a McDonald's hamburger almost the same at every location for everybody, boom, into an output that's a Big Mac or a cheeseburger sold to the customers, be they in France, Japan, China, Moscow, Los Angeles here, okay? Customers then are reacting again in the external environment, providing feedback, and the cycle begins. We've seen at fast food restaurants, there's a big interest in things like dollar menus. A dollar doesn't buy much food anymore, so we're seeing a shift in terminology towards the value menu, perhaps, and what you can get for $5 or less. Think of the famous Subway $5 footlong. That's affected by the economy and inflation. A different way of looking at the macro environment, here we have a diagram with three ovals and the components of the macro environment, and then we look at the competitive environment. Okay, so things that affect everyone would be the demographics of the country, the mix of languages, the ages. Our laws and regulations will apply to all companies. The technology available. When I do work in Africa, you cannot count on the internet being up 24 hours a day. You cannot count on electricity being up all throughout the day. And, you know, probably 99.9% of the time in the United States, you can assume those things will be on. There are occasionally disasters, but the norm is you'll have access to that. The competitive environment then are the rivals. Certain industries are very concentrated. When you think of soda, you probably think of two names, two giants that account for most of the sales. Who are they? Coca-Cola and Pepsi-Cola. Other areas are very wide open. So if you were to just think of the restaurant market in your town, there are the big chains, but there tend to be from dozens to hundreds to thousands of small businesses because barriers to entry for a restaurant are very small. Many of my students have tried to open restaurants and most of those restaurants are still not open. So they've been in, they've been out, some of them opened a second restaurant. Much different type of rivalry when you have lots of competitors. Suppliers, the people whose things you need. When you're making soda, you've got the components of your syrup, and you need carbonated water, and you need a container, normally aluminum container. For a restaurant, could be farm to table could be a couple farms. It could be you're buying stuff from your Costco or your Sam's Club. The buyers are your customers, new entrants. We described examples of those. And there are substitutes. When times get tough, restaurants often struggle because it's cheaper to make some macaroni at home, cook some rice at home, go to the grocery store and do the value-added work of cooking. So my cooking a meal at home is a substitute for a meal at McDonald's or the nicest restaurant. Not always, the quality's not always the same. Convenience isn't necessarily the same, but often the price is lower for the amount of calories that I need to consume. We move into the final oval, almost a circle there in orange, the internal environment. Okay, companies are different. We'll delve into this later. The culture of a company could be akin to the culture of a country. Some companies are known for being very strictly controlled. Some are known for being looser, letting employees figure out how to do things, and there's no one right way. Disney has a very famous culture. They changed the language. You're not a customer, you're a guest when you visit Disneyland. The values, Walt Disney had values around cleanliness. So even senior managers I met still will kind of race to pick up a piece of trash they see in the park because that's part of their values, that Walt Disney and Walt Disney's wife wanted Disneyland to be unlike other amusement parks that were considered dirty and unsafe. So that's become part of the value of the Disney Park brand. And then the climate, just how do people feel? Are people excited to work at the organization or do people seem unexcited? My first job graduating from college was with Procter & Gamble, calling on retail stores like Walmart, Target, and Kmart. Some of you might not even know what a Kmart is. I share the story because Walmart had a culture of entrepreneurship, and each store manager that I met had a lot of pride and excitement about how they managed the department I was there to talk to them about. Target was a little more corporate controlled. I had to make sales more to corporate and then they would be executed. But people seemed to be pretty happy to work at the Targets, but it was a little bit more uniform. Kmart had a climate that I thought predicted its demise, that people didn't seem happy, didn't seem as motivated, and the way in which I interacted changed because the climate just felt like one of suspicion and fear, really, rather than enjoyment of their job. Okay, the general task and internal environments get to what are the things that need to be done and who are the important parts of that. The customer, there's a task of providing to the customer. Competitors, the task of competing against the competitors, working with your suppliers, and then finding people in the labor market, employees, to come work for you. The internal environment are the employees, the culture, and the management. The general environment could be listed in these categories we already talked about, from global, legal, political, economic, sociocultural. The natural environment, which we haven't spent a lot of time on, the geographic factors. Some places are hot or colder. Some places have multiple seasons. California seems to have one season, maybe two. And then the technological environment. Now, I've talked to you about this recession. I've shared this graph here just so you can get a sense of what happens to employment. Okay, we've talked about the labor market. This is a way to visually look at the labor market for that 1982 recession, the 1990 to 91 recession. 2001, that was the dot-com collapse, the dot-com bubble burst, and then that 2007 to 2009. And what you can see in the graph is the years from the start of the recession along the bottom axis, and then how much employment fell, meaning what percentage of jobs disappeared. Now, if we follow the red line, this is why I call it the Great Recession. You see how that went down to 6% of the jobs being lost. And look at how long it took for that line to get back to zero. If you contrast that with the recession I experienced, graduating in 92, that only went down 2%, and the length for it to get back to zero was much shorter. For those of you older that remember the 80 recession, that was deeper, quite a bit, about 50% worse, went down to about 3%. But the recovery time was actually a little bit faster. It actually got back to zero faster. The dot-com collapse, 2001, that yellow line went down to only about 2%, but that lingered pretty long, which is why if we're looking at trends, the fear for our next recession, and there will be another recession in our lifetimes, I can be very, very confident we'll see these patterns repeat. If it follows that trend, could it go even lower? This is what people are afraid of, and could it take even longer to restore employment? That's going to affect your management decisions. Let's see how that's affect the retail sector. Here's a company we'll talk about in this course. We'll talk about Amazon. Some of you are probably Amazon customers, maybe even Amazon Prime customers. We can see in this graph the percentage of e-commerce jobs, jobs like those at Amazon, how fast they've grown. So we were looking before at an economy losing 3% of its jobs. Now this is just e-commerce jobs, a small number of jobs, but look at that rapid growth. We have to move the vertical axis up to 300% or three times as many jobs as there were previously. So e-commerce during this period from 2002 to 2016 was up 334%. Now there's another sector of retail that I mentioned in this class already that also is up. It's up a smaller percentage, but it employs more people, so its impact is greater. And that is the warehouse club or the warehouse store. Think of Costco and think of Sam's Club. Those are up 80%. So as you see your local shopping center, your mall closing, or you see the vacancies there and you think, wow, Amazon destroyed all these jobs and destroyed these companies, the picture's a little bit deeper, isn't it? We see actually as a manager, you should then be aware, it's not just Amazon, but the cities that are lucky to have these great big stores with really low prices like Costco, they've actually, some of those jobs have migrated there, as have a lot of the sales. So the economy is being efficient by just doing more mechanistic things, perhaps on a bigger scale. Remember, economies of scale, as well as the innovative companies bringing stuff, you know, delivering it to your home, sometimes same day with Amazon. Now on the bottom, you can see retail overall is pretty flat during this period, but there has been a decrease of 25% in your traditional retail store. So think of some of those shops you used to like to go to. This chart shows you the job picture a little bit differently in terms of number of jobs. The vertical axis goes up to plus 500,000, that's 500,000, or down a similar amount. Okay, so department stores, if we're looking at the very bottom graph, you'll see that they've shed nearly 500,000 jobs, 448,000, whereas the warehouse clubs have added 841,000. That's a story you might not have known before. Okay, the retail industry has gained 645 net. So it's lost jobs, but the warehouse jobs plus the e-commerce Amazon-type jobs have more than outpaced. That's a story you might not have known, but as a manager, you need to be aware that the skills people that want to work in retail need are different today than they were 20 years ago. Customer service is still important, but perhaps programming, social media, knowing how to drive people to your e-commerce site, or knowing how to negotiate the best deals for your warehouse store, or to create a warehouse store, might be skills that you would need that you didn't need before. I made mention to America and the trends about how retail is shifting to cities. For those of us that live in Los Angeles, where Dominguez Hills is located, things have been good. The jobs are coming here. Retail's fairly strong here, but that's not true for all of America. If you look at this map behind me, you will see that Minneapolis in the Midwest is doing well. That's a city that's prospering. Chicago is doing well. There's a lot of major cities there that aren't on the list. Milwaukee is not on that list. We have to go all the way to the south to Kansas City or to Denver or to St. Louis to see areas where you have a concentration of e-commerce jobs. And those are very correlated to our biggest cities, meaning the smaller areas are really getting left behind. The East Coast, Boston, New York, Philadelphia, D.C., great shape. Then we got to go down to Atlanta and Miami. Dallas in Texas, Phoenix, Las Vegas, San Francisco, Portland, Seattle, Salt Lake City. That's a lot of America that's being left out. It's kind of interesting if you want to look at the political changes in the country, there's a little bit of overlap with the areas that are booming with these knowledge economy jobs and how red or blue the states are politically. Let's now think about technology. Okay, what is technology? This is just learning to do things better, applying knowledge to a production technique, a way of managing, or a way of communicating with your customers. As this evolves, sometimes entire new markets develop. Okay? Before there was a smartphone, there was no big market for mobile apps. Think of how a mobile app is different from a program on your PC. Real-time mapping makes a lot of sense on a device you can take with you. You can use it as a navigator. Makes more sense than the same technology on your computer where you'd have to remember it, print it out. Other apps, messaging apps, where you can get information real-time over cellular networks are examples. So you could create an advertising company that uses a geo signal to know, hey, this customer is by your restaurant right now. Would you like to push them a notification that if they come in the next 10 minutes, lunch is 50% off? That's something you couldn't have done before. Communicating, pricing, it would affect how you manage. Okay, so that could be a new niche. Manufacturing has seen incredible gains in productivity. Most services have not. Most services, including this service right now, education, we haven't figured out a way for me to condense this information in a way that is 5 times faster than I could have done 20 years ago. We have found ways to make computers much more than 5 times faster for the same amount of storage or battery to be 2 to 5 to 10 times more efficient. So manufacturing seeing some things that we don't see in healthcare. It might still take one person to cut my hair. It might take one nurse 10 minutes to attend to my needs in the hospital. And so when we look at a relative share of these different service jobs in the economy compared to manufacturing, it's no surprise to me that America has lost lots of manufacturing jobs. As we've used technology, automation, and computers, we've really designed humans out of a lot of the work. But can we do that for caring professions? Can we do that for many service professions? The answer is no. If we look at overall productivity from 1947 to 2017, let's look at the productivity change. America is an amazing engine of economy. I think, you know, America's where it's at, very proud to be an American. A marvel at the productivity of our business sector. We're great competitors, and we have been for a long time. Now, in 2019, do I expect we're going to have this 3% productivity change that some people talk about? Absolutely not. If we look back historically, that's a number we haven't even achieved on these graphs, right? 2.8% is good. 2.6 from 2000 to 2007 was fantastic. More realistic goals, probably between 1.5% to 2%. Now let's look at what's happened in productivity from 87 to 2017. We've seen big spikes, 1990 to 2000, 2000 to 2007, and then more modest growth in this last 10-year period. As we shift to the service sector, let's look at the employment story. We see that non-agricultural employment, okay, people not working on farms, has been increasing. The percentage of people working has gone up. This is largely because women have been entering the workplace and moving from not working to part-time working to more women working full-time. And then the next graph, you'll see different sectors. And what I want to call to your attention is that line, the dotted line, manufacturing. So if we look at 1960, we can see we had 30% of people working in manufacturing. Follow the line down to just 2008, that's more than 10 years ago, that number has fallen by more than half to under 15%. Okay, what's risen, that solid black line, the first one, is business services. Business services has been growing, not as fast as manufacturing has been declining, but that's an area of opportunity. Let's look at the legal and political factors in your environment. We have government and the government regulations. We've got a current president who's very proud of cutting regulations, cutting red tape, boasts that he's cut the most of anyone. I haven't fact-checked that, but that's part of the news, and definitely I see evidence that regulations have been changed at the federal level. That affects the federal level, all U.S. companies. There also are changes at the state and local level. Often the trend is towards more regulation as we worry about climate change. We'll see environmental changes. So political activities, things like elections matter. Government agencies matter. So we have cabinet level agencies, Environmental Protection, Department of Labor. They make rules and regulations that can affect how much you pay people if you provide them benefits. Managers should be aware of pressure groups that will try to change the external environment by lobbying, by electing folks to perhaps put restrictions on companies. When we had the financial crisis, what happened? We had legislation passed to try to curtail some of the activities of banks and other bank-like activities. That's a natural reaction to people wanting to pressure organizations to work in a more responsible way. Some of the main agencies you want to be aware of as a manager would be OSHA. That's our safety, Occupational Safety Health Administration. If you're doing business across state lines, which nearly everyone is, Interstate Commerce Commission, Federal Aviation Administration affects flying, Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, anyone who hires has to abide by those. There are many laws protecting against discrimination in the employment. And the National Labor Relations Board, that applies to all companies. People tend to associate with unions, but even a non-union company could someday have an election to decide whether or not a union will be recognized, and the National Labor Relations Board fits in there. So as you should know, the American system has four levels of government. You see the seals there, the federal, the state, county. We're situated here in the United States of America, in the state of California, in Los Angeles County, and we're in the city of Carson here. I have the seal of Los Angeles, which is where I actually live. And sometimes people get confused when we talk about Los Angeles. We could mean the county, which includes the city of Carson, or we could mean the city. And I just wanted to show you a picture of the org chart if you wanted to think of the federal government as an organization. You don't always think about government that way, but we could represent it like we represent most companies. With the Constitution is what a president's sworn to uphold, and Congress and the justices are sworn to uphold, so we put that at the top. And then we have three branches, three areas of power. And this is in the political science course, so I won't go through the checks and balances, but just wanted you to think about the government that way. And then when we think of the cabinet, you see those report to the executive branch. Some of those agencies that I talked to are cabinet or report to the White House. If we look at the state of California, a state of about 40 million people, you'll see organizationally that's divided into 58 counties and 480 cities. The little graph I have on the bottom just give some data for people talking about, all the regulation in California is driving all the companies to Nevada. Nevada has lower taxes. Well, let's just look at the number. The top line shows the people leaving California, and the blue line shows the people coming in. So yes, there have been periods. You see a spike in 2005, looks like around 1992, of more people leaving than coming in. And now in more recent history, you see those track. So that's how some of these can affect the labor market, affect the external environment. Where are people going to, and where are people coming from? Well, there are a lot of people moving to Texas, probably because Texas is a large state, and it's not too far away. Arizona is next on the list. What does the profile of the person leaving California look like? Well, it's typically a family with kids and those with a lower education, only a high school education. They tend to move to Texas, Arizona, or Nevada. Okay? 5 million people in California make less than $12.50 per hour, and those are the people most at risk. It is very hard to live in the major cities in California on that wage. But doesn't mean people aren't coming to California. So if you look at the blue on the bottom of the graph, you will see people from New York, Illinois, and New Jersey are on net leaving those states to join the workforce. And those people look very different. They tend to be college educated, and they tend to be 18 to 35 year olds feeding in. The figure one on the bottom of your screen, you'll see, shows the occupations of those lower wage workers, the people, the skills that are leaving our state to go to the Texases or the Arizonas or Nevadas of the world, and Oregon and Washington as well, tend to be people in sales, food preparation and services, administration support, personal care, transportation, and moving. So, in this course, I want you to look at facts and work with facts to understand the implications of changes. We won't make good management decisions if we deny reality. We need to understand and interrogate it. Okay, the next organization we could look at would be the state of California. And here's a simple org chart. This state is very focused on citizens and things like recalls and initiatives and petitions. So we put the people on top. And then we have an assembly, a senate, a governor, and a Supreme Court. So not too dissimilar from the federal system. If we want to look at our county here, Los Angeles County geographically, you see we've got the ocean as a border, Ventura, Kern, Orange, and San Bernardino counties as our neighbors, and many cities within. The county itself is divided into five districts. You'll see one very big one to the north, and then smaller ones in the middle, districts 1, 2, 3, and 4. And the people that are currently elected as of 2019 to represent the people of districts 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, so if you're in Los Angeles, if you haven't seen a picture of who your supervisor is, there she or he is. Next level we'll talk about is the city. And in California, it's important to understand that counties make regulations that affect how you manage. The city makes regulations that affect how you manage. Some cities impose minimum wages. Some cities impose requirements for restaurants. Counties might have environmental regulations. We're very concerned about our air here in Los Angeles. We want to get back to a cleaner environment where we can see the mountains that surround us, you know, every day, not just some days. So that's kind of the context of why we're going through this. The city of Los Angeles has many communities. It's interesting, perhaps somebody who wasn't born here, that there's interesting carve-outs. I live in San Pedro, which you see was annexed and just barely connected to Los Angeles. Los Angeles goes down the 110 to the Wilmington and San Pedro areas, leaving Carson, Torrance, and some beach cities out of its control. Places like Santa Monica are also not part of the city, but they're part of the county. And then the city here has got a mayor as a leader, and then 15 districts with council people who are the managers, really managers of things. Do they do all the work? No, they delegate work to people like the city attorney, the controller, and then many, many staff positions. We also could look geographically at our school system. Everybody's entitled to a free public education, and the school district is not exactly the same as the city or the county. How is that relevant? Well, property taxes, which affect managers. They go in to feed the school district. So just so you can see, we have a board president right now from District 2 and 7 people elected to the school board. If you've been following the news, there was a strike. LA Unified had a strike recently, and the board is the ultimate decision maker with who employed the superintendent, gave a lot of direction on whether or not the district would be able to and should agree to what the teachers union was providing. So increases there could mean future property tax increases for managers and businesses. I here teach for the California State University, so I thought I'd just share our governing structure. We have a board of trustees that are responsible for the operations that is headed by the governor. Actually, you'll see that this is the way it was for the 2018 beginning. It's since changed because we now have a new governor. So Gavin Newsom would be on there, and the new lieutenant governor should be on this. Speaker of Assembly, state superintendent, and then our boss, the chancellor, Timothy White, are members of the Board of Trustees. There's the meeting schedule. So to do their work, they meet on a schedule of January, March, May, July, September, November. And they have a chair. And the chair makes a decision on the chancellor, who then has a team, a CFO, academic student affairs, HR, general counsel, auditor, and then a president for each of our 23 campuses. There also are appointed trustees. These people get selected by the governor, and there's the pictures of our trustees that provide guidance to our chancellor and other leaders. Okay, so I've given you a little bit of a management lesson about your government, but I also want you to realize that the people that you put in charge of the government agencies affect all the other businesses, whether they're nonprofits, other government entities, or your for-profit donut shop, or your nail salon, Those people can have power to regulate, power to maybe control parking around your business, the power to tax. And therefore, they're important to understand in the external environment. This is customized for the California audience, but same thing applies if you're in Minnesota, if you're in Indiana, or Georgia. All right, so again, we're thinking about this open systems perspective, the external environment, how does it affect your organization, how you need to manage as you produce your good or your service. What about the demographics? These are ways we would measure the people who could be in our labor force, could be in our customer set. And there are some trends in the United States. The labor force is growing. We're a country that does have many immigrants come. We are in need of many skills, and in spite of discussion of a wall or having fewer people illegally cross, we still are welcoming many immigrants to come work on work visas, things like the H-1B visa. The other trend is we have an increasing education and skill level as more and more people are taking courses like this. So congratulations, you're helping to increase the human capital of the United States, your city and your state. And that fits with this knowledge economy, the types of skills we need. Okay, I mentioned immigration, and I mentioned before, more and more women are working, and more women are working greater numbers of hours. So that's a trend, and the workforce, as is the country, is becoming more diverse. Okay, we're seeing increases in non-white or underrepresented populations. We're seeing increases in people from Asian countries, Latin American, countries like Mexico, Central America, Brazil, so it's becoming much more diverse than before. And here's a chart to encourage you to stay in this course, or if you're not enrolled for credit, to enroll for credit if this will help you complete your degree. Here we see the earnings ratio, okay? So high school is the base. Let's assume somebody went to high school, their ratio against themselves would be one, right? Whatever they make divided by that is one. So we can see from this that those who don't finish high school, on average, will make 74 cents to the dollar. Now, if you just took some college, maybe just this one class, right? It looks like you'd do better on average. That'd be $1.17. But I have bigger hopes and goals for my students. So an associate degree, 2 years worth of work, that gets you $1.23. You finish a four-year bachelor's degree, which is my typical student, wow, you've almost doubled from the high school, your value. That's a nice return for those 4 years and the tuition paid, especially at the Cal State rates. So $1.73. And then if you want to continue, I teach master's courses, so please check out my MBA offerings, and then you can double, or $1.98 per the dollar a high school student makes. And the sad news for those of us with PhDs is the doctoral degree, yes, it does mean that on average we get paid 2.65 times more, but the sad news for those of us that got a professional degree, like I did before the doctoral degree, that actually was the best investment. So I actually find the jobs that my master's in business affords me, that's a 3.36 times increase. So the JDs, the MBAs, actually increase your earning power more than a doctoral degree, which typically takes 4 to 6 years, whereas a professional degree is typically 2 to 3. So education is good, but don't, not everybody wants to necessarily crowd and get a PhD because there are only so many professor jobs or jobs require a PhD. And here we can see the same type of information a little bit differently, and we can start to ask ourselves the question, well, is it a good idea for the government to encourage people to go to school if we see that great return? What about offering scholarships and subsidies with tax dollars? Well, this evidence would suggest that after-tax income, the black line goes up, and if you add up what these people will pay in additional taxes, maybe it does make sense to subsidize those Pell loans or subsidize student loans. It looks like there's a pretty nice return, the amount of extra taxes somebody will pay on that extra income for the bachelor's, the master's, or the professional degree, make a pretty strong argument for even during a recession or even during tough times, we probably, as taxpayers and citizens, should be saying yes to education. We should be insisting on good management so our money's not wasted. But this return tends to be one of the best things we can spend our public money on. Okay, and that's kind of the management case, looking at the dollars in, dollars out. Now, the natural or the environmental concerns. You want to be sensitive. You don't want to be polluting rivers, because in today's environment you will often end up paying. And even if the laws permit it now, it may be prohibited, and with our legal system you might find yourself paying damages in the future. So young people, and I think this is a movement that started even before I was a college person, find that this is really important. This affects your brand, this affects the government's attitude towards you. And while the environment, Mother Nature per se, doesn't have a voice, I think people who've lived in cities of pollution like Los Angeles realize that no, this is not something we want to go back to. We do not want to have to wear smog masks in LA. We enjoy seeing the mountains. We would love to see our oceans a lot cleaner. It's depressing to go kayaking in the harbor and be able to fill your kayak with trash, right? So though it doesn't have a voice, there's a definite trend of people wanting to reduce pollution, move towards renewable energy for national security reasons, for cost reasons, to fight against climate change and global warming. And why wouldn't we want to take these scarce resources we have and use them more productively? We don't have unlimited amounts of all these rare minerals that create some wonderful products, so maybe we want to look at recycling programs like in European Union, countries like Germany, where that's factored into the management process before you even design and produce a product. The Environmental Performance Index in our book looks at the countries that are perceived to do the best by some experts. And Switzerland, Latvia, Norway, Luxembourg, those are all European countries at the top of the list. You don't see the United States very high, number 49. Interestingly, Costa Rica, it's been billing itself since I first visited there to see my friend Hernan back in 1989 as a eco-friendly place. There's a lot of ecotourism, and they've put this into their policies, their management of their firms, and their government's been aligned. They have a pretty darn good score for a small Latin American country. They're above France, Austria, Italy, and even Sweden. And Sweden and Germany you typically think of as good environmental countries. So this is something that can be done. Where's China on that list? Well, a lot lower. Okay, when we wonder why costs could be lower in China, perhaps there's this hidden cost of the environmental impact of companies. And if you visit Chinese large cities, the smog that you'll see today, you can breathe in the cost of some of the manufacturing. India, same thing, and then Iraq is kind of bottom of that list, so not doing particularly well in the environmental index. Social issues. These would be societal trends affecting how people think, what they want to do. This has implications to how you manage the workforce. Disney would run into problems as it would move into countries with its parks like France. There used to be a prohibition against male facial hair. That didn't go over very well in France. I think it's even been eased now in the California parks and the Disney parks because people have different views of what's fair. The Boy Scouts are now deciding to be not just a boys-only organization, but they're going to admit girls. So these are the types of things that can affect how you manage and do business. More and more women in the workplace has led for greater demand for family leave. Different attitudes towards gay, lesbian, transgender, queer, citizens have led to domestic partner benefits in companies. Flexible working hours fit the needs of today's worker. The fact that more and more parents are working, child care assistance are things that could affect how you manage. All right, so now we go to this model here, the competitive environment, exhibit 2.5 in your book, and we can think about how these different factors all interplay. So when we look at a sector, say we're going to look at the mobile phone sector, we can see new entrants. China has some new entrants that'll be entering. We're aware of Samsung, we're aware of Apple, we're probably vaguely aware of a company called Nokia that was mostly acquired by Microsoft. Okay, so the rival firms, potential new entrants, and then what's the substitute to a cell phone? Okay, well, the old landline phone, I guess, or maybe a tablet if people want to move to things like Slack or different ways of communicating. What's a complement? Well, boy, there are a lot of complements. Cell phone cases, these screen protectors, different charging accessories, wireless charging accessories. Suppliers are part of this ecosystem, the people who provide the components, and then the ultimate customers, what do people want. Are people tired of buying a new iPhone every year because their battery stops working? You might see change in the design of iPhones like we've seen. They say for sustainability reasons, and after the battery scandal, iPhones are expected to last 2, 3 or more years, which has a management impact at Apple. They probably will not be selling as many phones, at least phones to the same existing customer. Next, we want to introduce this concept of uncertainty. Okay, here we see a 2x, two graph here, which are very common in management. So we're looking at the rate of change in the factors of your environment, from low to high, and then the number of factors in the organization's environment, low to high. Okay, when there's very little change, very few things to keep track of, there's much lower uncertainty. Very regulated things like utilities, not a lot of things to consider. What's the cost of coal? Maybe what's the cost of wind power? And then what's the rate of change? Okay, not too many changes, though. With global warming, we see some of the electrical companies are worried about the grid, and the grid in very dry forest conditions has actually exposed companies like PG&E to some great liability. So maybe greater than before, but still compared to the dynamic mobile phone market, that would be an area where there are many changes, new battery technology, charging technology, screen technology. We have foldable phones now. We have concerns about privacy. We have phones that need to work in different countries with different internet standards. Lots and lots of factors, lots and lots of changes. China might decide to allow Google to do business again. Oh, that will be good for Android-based phones. So as you're trying to adapt to the environment, understanding these factors and the uncertainty is part of your job. Competition becomes more intense when you have more people to compete with. Okay, there's more angles of potential attack. Or when the industry growth is slow. Okay, when the market is growing, everybody can double in size, and that feels great because growth is exhilarating, and you might not care that somebody else grew 3 times and you grow 2 times. When there is no growth, the only way for you to make more money is to take market share from a customer. Okay, that's more competitive. It becomes a zero-sum game. Anything that Pepsi-Cola gets, Coca-Cola doesn't get. And when the product service is not easily differentiated, and that's why Pepsi and Coca-Cola spend millions of dollars to tell you their colas are very different. Even if it's just the type of person you are when you drink Pepsi, you're young and you're fresh and dynamic, that becomes essential in an industry with 2 major competitors and then lots of smaller competitors, your RC Cola, your store brand cola, and if you want to look at soft drinks more generally, a much wider variety. Okay, when we talk about new entrants, we want you to think about the barriers to entry. Okay, what makes it easy for people to come in? Those are the conditions that would prevent a new company from entering or make it easier. Government policies. Government could just say, hey, when it comes to using wireless frequency, we're going to auction the spectrum off, and whoever gets the bid, you're the only one that can use that. Makes a lot of sense. You don't want 2 people using the same frequency, the products won't work. Capital requirements. What if I wanted to start a new bank to compete with Citibank or Bank of America? Well, I probably need several $1 billion. Okay, that's a pretty big barrier to entry. I don't have many friends with $1 billion. I don't have $1 billion. If I wanted to start a restaurant, or say I wanted to start a food cart, that's not that expensive. I have enough money, I could go buy a food cart. I could go to the grocery store, get some ingredients, cook, and start that business. It used to be the city of LA kind of cracked down on street vendors. Well, the laws have changed, so there we've seen a barrier to entry reduced, and we might expect a larger number of people selling food on the street. Brand identification, that's why my first employer, Procter & Gamble, spent so much money on brands. Okay, they started out just making soap, Ivory soap, but now they sell soap for washing your dishes, products like Dawn. They sell products soap for washing your clothes, like Tide, but they don't just have Tide, they have Dreft, a special powder for babies. They have Tide for sensitive skin. They have Tide with different fragrances based on, kind of your mood, and Tide with no fragrances for those that are allergic. Okay, all brand identification, maybe around a particular name like Tide, and then maybe an extension. cost disadvantages and distribution channels. When you're manufacturing something in the United States, the labor cost is going to be higher than China, but the labor costs in China are typically higher than labor in Bangladesh. Okay, so you have to understand where your cost disadvantages are. Americans can still do great in areas where that's not the primary driver. You might have some advanced technology that required that four-year college education that is going to be scarce in a city like China. So making that product could give you a comparative advantage. You might make the same type of product, but a different way to compete. Maybe your product will have higher quality, greater customization. So these are things you want to think about. And then your distribution channels. Some products, to be reach an economy of scale, would want to be retailed by an Amazon, a Walmart, or a Target. So in a sense, those companies, if they let you in, can provide you a distribution channel that gives you an advantage. If a company like Costco says, we're only going to allow one company in this space, and you get that contract, good for you. If you don't get that contract, then that's going to be millions of sales you're not going to get because of lack of access to that distribution channel. What's a substitute? What's a complement? Use these words before. I'll go through them, so you're very clear, especially for those of you that have to take a quiz at the end of this. A substitute is just simply something you can substitute. It's an alternative to a product or service. And in some cases, services can be a substitute for a product. They give an example here. The Chipotle burrito bowl could be substituted for a Subway sandwich, okay? You're just kind of substituting one lunch for another. Dell laptop computer could be substituted with the iPad tablet computer. Face-to-face course could be supplemented with an online course. And a USB flash drive could be substituted with an online backup service. See, we have a physical product being replaced with the service. Starbucks coffee could be substituted with any coffee, but now we move on to complements in the bottom of this exhibit. A complement is something that will increase purchases of other products, or things that go together. Think of shoes, right? You want a right shoe and a left shoe. Most people have 2 feet, so they'll need that. Another complement to shoes in general would be socks, okay? Another complement could be, if you really want to be stylish, you might want pants that match your socks and shoes and a belt that matches your shoes. Those might be natural complements. You want to get the color just right. Okay, so Starbucks coffee goes really well with coffee cake in this example. I've actually never had the coffee cake there, but it makes sense. Netflix streaming video could go well with popcorn. Okay, popcorn in a movie at home. Evernote app. This is a great note-taking app I've been using. I don't get paid to give commercials here, but it's on there. It's something that I like. And their complement is something I spent, I think, $300 on, the Evernote scanner. So at home, when I have important documents, I run them through the scanner, and I know that it'll be in my Evernote for life. I'll have a digital copy of that that I could pull up my phone right now, look it up. I can take it with me to China when I travel or wherever I am. An apartment rental. Complement to that would be IKEA furniture. Okay, that type of furniture, easier to assemble, easier to fit into smaller rooms. Considered a good example of a complement. Suppliers, again, I do know I've used this word before. The book has a definition. It's those who provide a resource or an input needed to produce your product. Switching costs, what is that? That's a cost that you incur if you change suppliers, fixed costs. Well, what could that be? Let's say I'm mad at my DirecTV and I want to switch to Dish TV. If they made me buy a new dish, that could be a high cost. What have most of these companies done? They've taken that away so you don't have a switching cost. They incur the switching cost, but they normally don't charge it directly as a $100 or $200 fee to the customer. When you buy a mobile phone, if you have a plan that requires you to buy out of your contract, that would be a switching cost. So certain carriers, I think there's one called likes to call itself the Uncarrier in branding, T-Mobile, likes to talk about they're reducing the switching costs and just charging it directly, whereas maybe competitors, when you get a new phone, you're locked into that service for 2 years or 3 years. Supply chain management, this is a great focus. When you finish this course, know that you can study general management, but you also could focus on supply chain management. And those of you located near the Port of Los Angeles or the Port of Long Beach, always have lots of people looking for students with this skill set. Simply said, the definition of the term is how you manage acquiring materials, transforming them into products, and distributing them to customers. So in the port, this is so important. There's so many goods that reach LA that need to be sold throughout the United States. Or there might be parts for manufacturing plants that need to get put on a train or a bus or a truck, probably not a bus, but a truck, to go where it needs to go. And optimizing that, because sometimes a train cost could be lower than the semi cost. Sometimes the speed is more important, so you might actually want to move it from the port to an airplane and FedEx it somewhere. So supply chain management's balancing all these different variables, kind of dealing with some of that complexity or uncertainty we talked about before, and those degrees are in really, really high demand. So you can do yourself a favor by checking that out if it sounds interesting. All right, in our next episode, we're going to talk more about environmental factors. We'll talk about uncertainty and complexity. That's it for this episode. Thank you for spending time with me. Again, it's Professor Thomas Norman, California State, Dominguez Hills, Management 310.